Sing the praises. We want to welcome you to church. We hope that you feel at home this morning. If you're new here, we're so glad you're here. Make yourself at home, okay? We're going to sing songs. Maybe you don't know them. That's okay. You can clap along with us, read the words, sing along if you like, and let's worship God together. Are you ready to seek the Lord with me today?
Yeah.
All right, one, two, three,
with one of the most special parts of something that we do here at church was the baby dedication. And this is a family that many of you are probably familiar with. This is Maggie and Andrew Granlund. I know you see them sing up on stage, and Maggie is on our staff with guest services. And this is big sister Ruby, whose birthday is today. And they have come today to dedicate the handsome Mr. Pace, Anders Granlund. Hey, buddy. You doing good? You excited? Maggie said he woke up extra happy today. I said, it's dedication day. And Maggie and Andrew, this is so special for me, because when I first met you guys, you were newlyweds. And I remember a lot of fun days in the young professional ministry. And little did you know that a few years later, Maggie, you went to Africa and a lady prayed over you and God blessed you guys with Ruby. And then a few years later, he blessed you with Pace, whose name so symbolizes him to me. Peace and strength is what Pace Anders mean. And I see that in this young man. And Maggie and Andrew, I have watched you raise your children in a godly home, and I want to affirm that. And I know you're standing before the church today to say that you want to continue in that. So the first thing I want to do is ask you guys a couple of questions. Do you trust Jesus?
Yes.
And do you accept Pace as a gift from Jesus?
Yes.
And will you continue to raise your children in a home where the Lord's name is proclaimed?
Yes.
Big buddy, you see your picture? He sees us on the screen over there. Hey, I'm right here. Pacey, your parents have chosen a very special verse that I want to read over you. It's from Psalm 116. And it says, "Be at rest once more, O my soul, for the Lord has been good to you, Pace. For you, O Lord, have delivered my soul from death, my eyes from tears, and my feet from stumbling, that I may walk before the Lord in the land of the living." Mom, I'm going to give this to you. Will you come see me? Pacey, come here, big buddy. Can you say hi to everybody? Can everybody say, "Hey, Pace"?
Hey, Pace.
They love you. Yes, they do. And those dimples are going to melt every heart out there. So Maggie and Andrew have family that have come with them today, and there are some watching from home. And it's so important to have family support you, but this is why God has designed the church. So that when families like Maggie and Andrew stand before us, we say, we want to come around you and support as you raise Ruby and as you raise Pace. So if you will be a part of encouraging and supporting Pace with Maggie and Andrew, will you respond by saying, "We will"? Okay, buddy. Jesus loves you and this church loves you, okay? So I'm going to pray over you. Lord Jesus, I thank you so much for Maggie and Andrew and their commitment to you, and that you have blessed them with this young man whose name symbolizes peace and strength. And Pace, I pray that all the days of your life that you will love the Lord and that you will continue to grow in peace and strength, and that your life will be a testimony to his goodness and his faithfulness. We love you as the church. Jesus loves you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's celebrate Maggie and Andrew again. Love you guys.
Awesome. Would you stand up with us? We're going to sing a song that was written for our church, for Mountaintop. This is our mission, that we would burn for God, that we'd be on fire for God. Okay? 2, 3, 4.
Turning from my past.
fire for you. We can't be like, we're fire for you. Okay, that's not good. Are you with me, church? Are you with me? All right, so I'm going to say, we are your people. We are the church. We are fire for you. Are you with me?
You are. me invite you to take just a moment, if you would, and if it's comfortable, you just kind of close your eyes and bow your heads just for a moment. And this song we've been singing invites us, reminds us that there are places in our lives where we just feel overwhelmed, and maybe the water's too high and the ocean's too deep, but in the presence of our Savior, we can move into places that we couldn't all on our own. And maybe there's some place in your life where that's how it feels right now. Maybe it's at work, something going on with your job. Maybe it's a health issue you're facing. Maybe it's with a friendship. Maybe you're at school, and maybe it's at home, a relationship, your marriage, a relationship with a kid. Maybe it's just kind of a struggle to make sense of things going on in the world, and it just feels overwhelming to you right now. Wherever it might be, just take a moment and invite Jesus to come into that place. To come and to take your hand and to strengthen your faith, to steady your feet, to show you what it looks like to trust Him completely without any borders around it, without any limitations. Lord, we know that when we do that, the places in our lives where we feel overwhelmed, when we invite You to come in and You to be right there with us, Lord, that You will take us to places we never could go on our own. And that in You we will find strength, and in You we will find encouragement, for in You we find hope. And so, Jesus, I pray that wherever we may find ourselves this morning, that You would be bringing that kind of hope into our lives, that You might be reminding us that we really are Yours, and that You love us, and that Your love can transform even those places that threaten to overwhelm us. And we pray that as we worship You this morning, as we dig into Your word, as we sing songs of praise to You, Lord, that we might know that You are present with us, and that in Your presence anything is possible. We pray all of that. We do it in Your name. Amen. Amen. Well, good morning, and we are so glad that you are here this morning. Help each other know that you're glad they're here. Find somebody, turn, give them a smile, a roll tide, whatever you need to do, and let them know you're glad they're here. If you're watching online, so glad you get to plug into Mountaintop this way. Why don't you take a moment, check in, let us know where you're watching the service from this morning, and who's watching the service with you, and we're so glad you're here. Hey, we really are glad you're here this morning. I'm kind of smiling. I can hear Jamie back there on the keyboard starting to warm up the Michael Jackson song they're going to do in a minute. But just be patient. I've got things I want to do first, okay? So, yeah. If you are new here, we banter like that a lot, and that's okay. But we're glad you're here. And maybe that you responded to an invitation that somebody gave you to come check us out on the mountaintop, and you found us here. And we just want to say a word of welcome to you. We're glad that you found us up on the mountaintop. We would love to tell you more about who we are as a church. Very simply, we're a community that is learning and sharing a better way of life that we believe can only be found in Jesus Christ. We're convinced that Jesus offers us a way to live forever and a better way to live today, and life really is better with Him. And so everything we do is about that, and we would love to tell you more about it. You can help us to do that. If you are new here for the first time, hopefully you got one of these study guides when you came in. And on the very last page, there's a little tear-out card, and we'd love it if you would tear that out. And later in the service, you can put it in an offering bucket, or you can take it out to the atrium, to a place called Starting Point. And there are people there. They have a gift for you and lots more information about the church. If you aren't new here, I hope you brought this back from last week. Our goal throughout this series for studying the book of Amos is that you would use these study guides as tools, and that you'd carry them around with you, and you'd use them in small groups and for personal devotion and in the services as well. So hold on to these and make sure you get one. You'll also find in the book lots of information about some of our ministry partners, and throughout this series on Amos, we are working with some of our off-the-mountain Mountain ministry partners, and I'll tell you more about one of them in just a moment. Before I do, next Sunday evening, we have an event that happens every year about this time that we are real excited about. And this year, we're kind of even more excited because we're going to work with one of our ministry partners in it. But we have an event called Punk Your Trunk. And Punk Your Trunk is a way for kids and adults, because some of you like to dress up, and there are prizes for that, so that's a good thing. But kids at our church and in the community to come, and they go trunk or treating. And we set up groups around the church, and some individuals set up trunks out in the parking lot. And I was talking to a guy this morning. Some of them get super elaborate, kind of crazy. He was asking me if he could have a generator because he had a lot of power he needs to run to go with his trunk. So I am really looking forward to what they're going to come up with. But it's just a lot of fun. It's a big outreach to the community. There's some of these invite cards that you can take and help make invitations. But one of the things that that we need, if you're not doing a trunk, you cannot imagine how much candy gets given out at Punk Your Trunk. Dentists in town just think we're awesome in November because we're going to give out so much candy next week. And some of you can help out just by bringing candy next Sunday. And we've got some buckets outside that say candy donations. And the idea is just to put the candy in the candy buckets. And then we'll that'll just help some of our groups distribute candy next week. Does that make sense? So go buy some candy. I like the little Snicker bars and but don't buy it for me. But just buy some candy and just if you would be willing to donate that. The other thing we're going to do a little bit different this year because we're in the midst of the series on Amos and looking at being part of God's flood of justice. One of our Off the Mountain ministry partners is Oak Mountain Missions. And so next week we are going to charge admission for Punk Your Trunk. And by admission, all we mean is we're going to ask everyone who comes to bring one canned good that we can go to give to the food pantry down at Oak Mountain Mission. They do a marvelous job down there. It is an incredible ministry partner for us. And in fact, we wanted to introduce them to you this morning. And so we're going to do that by video, if you would take a look at the side screens.
And I'm in Pelham today at Oak Mountain Ministries, which is one of our local partnerships. I'm here with Roddy Cooper. And a few years ago, we had something called Abba's Pantry at the church, and we decided to close the pantry and instead partner with Oak Mountain Missions because they do it full service. And so, Roddy, will you tell them a little bit about what Oak Mountain Missions does?
Oak Mountain Missions is a food pantry, a clothes closet. We do financial assistance. We give cars away. We give furniture away. We have different levels the way referrals come in. Our faith support churches, I think we have over 30 now.
So one of the things that you just said was if someone is in need of assistance, what they do is they come to us and then we make a referral to Oak Mountain Missions and then you guys take it from there.
If it's someone that needs assistance with clothing or food, then you can give referrals to that. If somebody needs other assistance, then they can contact us and we'll give them the process of who they need to get in touch with. Maybe if we walk and I can show you some of the rooms and tell you what we do.
I love it. Let's go.
This is our men's area where the men come and get their clothes.
Okay. That's awesome.
We don't keep, our policy is if you want to wear it yourself or dress your husband or your children in it, don't keep it.
Which I love.
We don't want it. And we don't send it off to another place. Prayer chapel, we felt like it was very important since we are here to share the love of Christ to those that feel like they aren't loved. And we have a place where people put prayer requests and on occasions we are asked to go in and pray with people.
Yeah, which is important for them to know that God provides.
Exactly. The little girls' room. As you can see, everything is well stocked. We have a great volunteer staff, which we need more people from Mountaintop to come up here and volunteer. This is our little boys' area where they can come in. They can pick out to 7 outfits, and that's like 7 shirts, 7 pair of pants, shoes, whatever. This is our linen area.
Okay.
The volunteers come in. People by referral can come in, get their things for the bed.
Sure.
Our women's room, which we have an abundance in it at all times.
Because women like clothes, you know, we need that.
but we need it, and they go out pretty quick.
Okay.
And then our food pantry. they get an ample amount of food just from the pantry.
Volunteers can bag up the groceries for people,
Everything is bagged up for them. When they come in, they'll go up to front to Diane. Diane will give them a number. She'll call out family number 6 with a family of 5. Mm-hmm. And so that way they'll know how many people are in it, so that they may, you know, add a little bit more.
Perfect.
Barbara is into our new freezers that we've just, I guess we received them probably around March, something like that.
So someone can come in here and get, like you said, once a month?
Once a month they get food. And they'll go, when she calls out the number in the family, that's how they'll know how much to come out here and get of these things. These freezers have just been fantastic.
Wow.
It allows us to have more meat.
And they're able to get good, healthy food that lasts.
Good, healthy food.
Yeah. So as we have walked through the warehouse, I have seen tons of volunteers here helping do all of this. So what if someone from Mountaintop wanted to volunteer, when can they volunteer and what do you need them to do?
They need to contact Diane Cicerio.
Okay.
We have forms they fill out. They can come on a schedule that fits them.
Okay.
We have a few days that we need to fill in more than others.
Okay.
They say if they want to work in the pantry, if they want to work in the clothes closet, if they want to work in the warehouse.
So Mountaintoppers, there are many ways that you can get involved at Oak Mountain Missions. If you want to volunteer, email Diane at oakmountainmissions@yahoo.com and she will get you set up. There's lots to do.
There's more information about Oak Mountain Mission in your study guide, and their email address and website is in the very back of it. But if you want to find out more about how maybe you could volunteer and be a part of that, go by the iServe booth after the service, and somebody there can tell you about ways that you can plug in and do that. But here's what you can do right now. And again, throughout this Amos series, we don't want to just talk about God's justice. We want to be a part of it. So here are three things that you can do this week. One, you can bring candy for Punk Your Trunk. Snickers bars, really good deal. But bring candy for Punk Your Trunk. Bring canned goods. Second, bring canned goods when you come, and you bring your friends for Punk Your Trunk. And thirdly, our ushers are going to come forward now, and this is a chance each week in the service that we have to give back to God out of the blessings He has given us. 10% of everything that you give, and this is true every week, but 10% of everything that you give, we give away to ministry partners like Oak Mountain Missions to be able to help bring God's justice here in Birmingham and in places all over the world. So when you give this morning, you are investing in ministries that are helping to bring a flood of justice. And so let's give joyfully and let's give gratefully and with expectancy of what God's going to do as we continue to be a part of His justice.
1, 2, 3. Soft with no hope.
excited about being up here. I jumped up about three times over there. That song made me want to moonwalk. Anybody else? I am not going to do that up on the stage because you will get up and leave. I have to confess, I've always loved that song. And you know what's funny about old songs like that is because now I realize, oh, that's the words. You know, it's like Benny and the Jets. You sing a song, you're like, oh, that's what the words of that song are. So, and it is such an appropriate song, Man in the Mirror. Because during this series in Amos is asking us to take a look in the mirror. And so the question that I believe that God wants us to answer today is, are we willing? Are we willing to look in the mirror? And I'll invite you right now, if you have a Bible, to go ahead and open up to Amos chapter 4. That's where we're going to be focusing on today. And in case you have missed or not been able to, just have forgotten over the course of a couple of weeks, I want to do a little recap for you. In the very first week, Doug talked about Israel. And he had to make sure that we knew what he was talking about when he used the word Israel. And I want to bring us back to that today because next week this is going to look different. So when I talk about Israel today, Israel was a nation that was divided into two kingdoms. There was the northern kingdom, and that was called Israel. And then there was the southern kingdom that was called Judah. And the capital of the northern kingdom was Samaria, and the capital of the southern kingdom was Jerusalem. So I want you to keep that in mind. And Amos, God chooses an ordinary man named Amos to do something specific. He calls Amos to restore the roar. And that's a phrase that I hope you will keep in your mind because Amos was chosen by God to do a difficult task. He had to go to the Israelite, the northern kingdom, and Amos was from the southern kingdom. So here's this ordinary guy who is going to go to the northern kingdom of Israel and give a very difficult word. And Israel had a problem because they had developed a sense of entitlement. And they were a smug, self-righteous people who thought that they were immune to divine judgment. They kind of thought that they were above the law, that they were above responsibility. And Doug talked about this last week. His message was called, "With Blessing Comes Responsibility." And Israel had decided she didn't want to be about justice. But they were supposed to be about justice. And kind of the working definition that we're using during this series is that justice is putting the world back to rights. And that was God's heart. That is God's heart, is justice and righteousness. And because Israel was his people, that was supposed to be their heart. And it's not. And so God uses this ordinary man to come and confront Israel. And let me just assure you that they are not happy when Amos comes to them and says, God is not pleased with you and bad things are coming. And so I want you, it's important as we're engaging the word to get in our mind's eye the picture here. So imagine this guy standing before people and he's going to tell them that God's not happy. And in their minds, they are saying to him, I'm sorry, Amos, do you know who you're talking to? Because we're Israel. We're God's people. And the last time we checked, God has our back. And by the way, who in the world are you anyway? And so that's kind of the scenario that we enter into today. And what I want to do is look back at what did Amos say to them? And then why has God brought this book into my life and into your life to hear? How does God need to roar at us to restore the roar in our lives the same way he had to do in Israel's? God, as we engage your word, may our hearts right now be open to you. Lord, you want us to hear this. So I pray that you will remove any distraction and that our hearts will be solely focused on you right now so that we may hear from you. Help us to hear from Amos. In your name I pray, amen. So when we get to chapter 4, in the first couple of verses, Amos uses poetry. Now, why is that important? Well, if you were here on Wednesday nights during September and October, we had a professor come and teach us on the different genres that are used in Scripture. So within Scripture, there's law, there's gospel, there's poetry. And I want us to understand that God is intentional when he speaks through an author to use a certain literary style. And so Amos, within his poetry, uses literary techniques like irony and sarcasm. And he uses an unfamiliar language with Israel because it had everything that he's going to say to them has become cliche. And so he had to do something different to gain a hearing from a people who weren't interested in what he had to say. So when Amos stands before the northern kingdom, he wanted to shock them and to wake them up from the fog of self-delusion that they were in. And as we talked about in week one of the reasons that Israel was in denial as to what Amos was talking about was because from the outside, Israel had everything going for them. Their economy was up. Their religious institutions were thriving. Their military made people feel secure. But the problem is that though everything was right on the outside, the people were rotten. And they have two big problems that Amos is going to address in chapter 4. One was a social problem and one was a church problem. So here are the accusations against them. In the verses 1 and 2, the problem that Amos is going to address, the social problem that Israel had, was narcissism. And in the first two verses, he says to them, "Hear this word, you cows of Bashan on Mount Samaria." Remember, that was the capital of the northern kingdom, Samaria. You women who oppress the poor and crush the needy, and say to your husbands, "Bring us some drinks. The sovereign Lord has sworn by his holiness, the time will surely come when you will be taken away with hooks, the last of you with fish hooks." So, when Amos stands before them in these first couple of verses, he is specifically addressing the upper class women of Samaria, and he calls them cows. Now, women, can we all agree, good job on the shock value, right? I mean, women are already like, excuse me, I do not think so. But he poetically uses the imagery of the cows of Bashan, because these women would have known about this place called Bashan. And in Bashan, the herds were famous. They were fat. The cows were fat, which symbolized fertility, which was a sign of prosperity and pride. So when he is talking to these women, they are prosperous and they are very, very prideful. And Amos calls them out, and by using this illustration, he says, "Women, I want you to know something. You are self-indulgent and greedy consumers. You're all about me, myself, and I. You are the center of your own universe." See, the problem with these women is that they viewed people as things to be used, and they did whatever they had to do to get ahead at the expense of others. And these women were making demands of their husband in an effort to keep up with the Joneses. They were making demands of their husbands to give them a luxurious lifestyle. They had to keep it up, keep it up, keep it up with the newest thing, the newest thing, the newest thing. And because these men who were guilty also were trying to give these women the lifestyle that they were demanding, they were going into the marketplace and cheating people. And they were perverting justice. And when I read these couple of verses, it reminds me of a person that you may be familiar with in the New Testament. Do you remember the story of Zacchaeus? If you know the song, Zacchaeus was a wee little man who climbed up in a sycamore tree. But if we remember who Zacchaeus was, he was a wealthy tax collector who financially benefited from an oppressive economic system. And if you don't know the story, it goes like this, that Zacchaeus hears that Jesus is coming into town, and because he was short, he climbs up into a sycamore tree, and when Jesus comes by, he looks up into the tree, and he sees Zacchaeus, and he says, "Hey, Zacchaeus, come down, because I'm going to your house today." And when the people hear Jesus say that, they say, "Are you kidding me? Do you know who that guy is? He's a cheat. He robs us all the time." Jesus says, "Oh, I know who that is. And what you guys don't know is I'm about to offer Zacchaeus a better way of life, a different way of life. And if he will only accept this, you will see a change." And Zacchaeus comes down, and we don't know exactly how the conversation went, but what we do know is that whatever Jesus said to Zacchaeus, Zacchaeus leaves that dinner, and he goes, and his life is radically changed, and he pays back four times what he had robbed from people. Jesus presented him with a better way, and his actions were different. And Israel knew this same God. But her actions indicate the opposite. No repentance, no generosity, no concern for others. And Amos is clear that God's going to judge the women for this, and they can bank on it because he swears by his holiness, which means it's a given. And what the women don't know at this point is that 40 years after Amos prophesies, a nation called Assyria is going to come and conquer Israel. And these leading women are going to be taken away with fish hooks through their noses or their lips, because this is what Assyrian kings would do to their conquests. They would hold their enemies by ropes tied to rings or hooks in their faces. That gives me the heebie-jeebies every time I say that. But that's what was coming for these women. Now, hear this. When Amos is telling these women this, they think he is crazy. Because here they are in their wealth, and at this time, Assyria wasn't even a big deal. And yet what Amos is saying to them is that, hey, ladies, you and the people in this nation are going to be conquered and defeated and humiliated. Women, the tables are going to turn. They had treated the poor like animals, and now they were going to be treated similarly. And Amos poetically says, the cows of Bashan are going to return to their pasture. Amos was not the favorite guest preacher in those days, as we all laugh nervously. Let's take a look in the mirror. What does this mean for us? Narcissism, which I think that we can all kind of agree in our culture, is a fairly easy thing to move towards. Narcissism says this. Narcissism says we are more important than someone else. Now, I want to throw out here that I think that most of us don't walk around thinking that we're better than other people. But what about the times that we walk into a store and someone's not going fast enough for us because our time is more important than their time? What we need is more important than whatever's going on with them. Narcissism says we have a sense of entitlement. Narcissism says that we have a lack of empathy for others. So let's ask a couple of questions to ourselves to see, do we need to do some inventory around this in our lives? So let me ask you, let me ask myself this. And I have been asking myself this the whole time that I'm preparing for this. Do we care about the plight of others, or are we more concerned with ourselves? Do we turn off the TV when we hear about things going across the world? Because if we turn it off, then it's like it doesn't exist. It's not our problem. It's too big or complex for us to deal with anyway. Are we, am I, more concerned about the likes that I get on a Facebook post than what God thinks about me? Am I more concerned about what you're going to think about this sermon, or honoring God in my preaching? Are we nice to people in church, but hateful to the Starbucks lady who gets our order wrong? You ever notice how it's easier to be rude to strangers? Ever been somewhere and acted a certain way and turned around and either saw someone that you knew or thought you saw someone you knew and started sweating? And I'm saying that because I did that the other day in the post office. And felt this big and felt like God was like, this is you. We might not be rich women who are asking our husbands to cheat people, but do you think that the church is viewed as the light of the world today or just another burnt out bulb? We are called, church, to be a light to a hurting world. And can we all agree that the world is hurting right now? that there are catastrophes going on. Some of you are going through catastrophes in your personal lives. And we certainly know that on a national level and on an international level that people are hurting. And when catastrophes happen, we can't always explain them perfectly, right? Why do bad things happen to good people? That's the age-old question. But even though we can't explain them perfectly, God asks us to act in light of them. And catastrophes, when they come into my life or your life or in other people's lives, they make every single one of us ask, is there any hope? Can anything good come out of this? Who can right all of this wrong? And we are called by God to go into a hurting world and be a light and tell the nations that God can. Church, let me hear from you. Can God? Yes. Do you believe this? God is the answer for a broken and hurting humanity. And when we don't live that out, God is not happy. And God wants our relationship with Him to be reflected in our lives. And when it's not, when we realize that this is what Amos wants us to do today, is just be honest. When we realize that we are there and narcissism is a problem, then we have to admit either one of two things. We have to either admit that we don't have a relationship with God, or that we do, and we're doing just exactly what Israel did, which is sticking our fingers in our ears and saying, la, 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 la. This is not me, this is not me, this is not me. And there's an unwillingness to repent. See, there's nothing wrong with saying something's a problem. There is something wrong when we know something's a problem and we don't do anything about it. As we read on, the second accusation, so he says narcissism is a problem. And in verses 4 through 5, the second accusation that he's going to bring against them is empty, superficial worship. And so he continues on in shock value when Amos sarcastically says in verse 4, go to Bethel and sin, and go to Gilgal and sin yet more. See, here's why this would have been so shocking to them, because when we hear the names of these places that we don't really know, it's kind of like, huh? What does that mean? But Bethel and Gilgal were important worship sites in Israel's history. They had heard the story of the patriarchs who had gone to these places and met with God. And they represented a contact point between heaven and earth. And now these places had become centers of false worship and centers of idolatry. So let me kind of bring this into modern day. Israel's places of worship had become so corrupt that it would be like if you and I were driving down I-65 and we saw a billboard for a church that said, come to this church and sin. And Amos says, instead of calling the Israelites to go and worship at these places, he says, you know what? It might be better if the doors were closed. And we need to understand that Israel would have been blown away by Amos's comments, and here's why. Because on the outside, they were doing everything right. They were doing everything that God had instructed them to do in the Torah. They went beyond the call of duty with their offerings and their sacrifices and their tithes. They had, and the New Testament talks about this, they had the outward form of godliness, but the problem was they had denied its power. See, people were ignoring the plight of others, even though they were flocking into the pews at every opportunity. And the truth was, the more they increased their gifts and their sacrifices, the more their sin grew because they had a heart problem and their worship was empty. Israel was not focused on God or their neighbors, but only in fulfilling their religious rituals. They were worshiping worship, but they weren't worshiping the object of who their worship was supposed to be for. Worship was fulfilling their needs, but it certainly wasn't fulfilling God's desire for worship with mercy and sacrifice. So, let's take a look in the mirror. Do we have a church problem? Are we coming here and going through the motions of our religion Yet our everyday lives don't indicate that we have any relationship with God. Let me go a little bit deeper and tell you what was going through my mind about myself as I was going through this. When we come to church on Sunday mornings, do we come and say, I hope the sermon better be good. They better be singing the songs that I like. And we kind of easily move. And let me tell you, can we all agree that every single one of us has a tendency to do this? And this is why I believe that God is like, wake up. Do we come in here saying, what am I going to get out of this? And then leave saying, well, that wasn't so good. This wasn't so good. And just move on. What if I believe that a question, if we would ask ourselves a different question, instead of saying, what am I going to get out of this? I believe that our worship experience could fundamentally and foundationally change if instead of saying, what are we going to get out of this? If we came in here and we said this, God, what do you want me to learn that would make me more effective for you? Because here's what we know, church. If we are willing to hear from Jesus Christ, then every single time that we gather as a body of believers, every single time that we engage His Word, we will hear from Him. We will. And Amos reminds us that it is possible to go through all the outer religious motions and our inner life be empty. And when that happens, we need an awakening. Israel loved the ritual of worship, but they weren't worshiping in spirit and in truth. And God knew their hearts, and He knows our hearts. We can't trick God. If our worship is empty, God's not just going to look the other way. God roars at us through Amos and says, I don't want your empty rituals. What I want from you is your relationship with me. And that relationship with Him will lead us when we realize that we look into the mirror and see things that narcissism and empty worship might be a problem in our lives. Then it allows us to get on our knees before Him and ask for forgiveness. See, God doesn't care if we nod or say amen or take notes during a sermon if we leave here and act no different. The Old Testament book of Daniel, if you remember the story, if you don't, in the Old Testament book of Daniel, there's this really amazing time where the king is doing exactly what we're talking about here. And so God writes on the wall with an invisible hand, which is just the most incredible story to me. And He writes four words on the wall. And it says, Meeny, meeny, tekel, parson. And that word tekel that is written on the wall means that God had looked at that king and found his heart lacking, wanting. If God put my heart on a scale, if God put your heart on a scale right now and said, if the weight of this will indicate whether you're empty for me or full, what would the scale say? And in verses 6 through 13, Amos reminds Israel that they have been warned. And they were warned first in two, they were warned in two ways. In God's covenant to them, when we read back in the early parts of the Old Testament, and God said, I'm going to use you as a nation of people to represent me, He gives them a covenant. And He is crystal clear in His covenant that if you obey me, because I know what is best for you as your father to these children, if you obey me, then you will receive blessings. And if you disobey me, then you will receive curses. Crystal clear about that from the beginning. And so He warned them that way. And then also Israel was warned seven times by God through crises that had come upon them as a nation. They were warned through famine, drought, several agricultural problems, defeat in battle. And here's the thing that Amos wants us to understand, church. Seven indicates the number of completion, and now God is done warning them. And the plagues, here's the tragedy about these plagues that had come to Israel. If In Exodus, which is coming out soon, and I can't wait to see it, but in the Old Testament book of Exodus, the story goes that the Egyptians had taken the Israelites into slavery. And so when they did that, God was not pleased because the Israelites were his people. So God sent plagues onto the Egyptians to let his people go. And Israel would have remembered that. And the reason that God did that is because Egypt was God's enemy when they had his people enslaved. And yet God is now having to use plagues on his own people because they have become his chief enemy. And they are experiencing consequences. And here's what you and I need to remember. You know, it's easy when we look at the Old Testament to think God seems like this cruel God and then he changes and becomes this nice God in the New Testament. No. See, God spoke through Amos to Israel then, and Israel represents us. We are prone to wander, Lord, we feel it. Prone to leave the God we love. And we need to see this God not as some cruel God who's just going to zap his people, but as a loving father who is concerned for his wayward children. Those of you who in here who are parents, we just saw two parents dedicate a baby this morning. If you saw your kid heading toward disaster, wouldn't you do everything in your power to say, please come back? Please don't go there. Please don't date this guy. Please don't do that drug. Please don't get involved with those friends. And you would warn them because you love them. And that's this God that we need to see. This God has given Israel chance after chance after chance to repent and acknowledge God as her creator and redeemer who knows best. Just like he does with us. And up until Amos 4, verse 11, Israel was in the 11th hour. There was still time to repent. But Israel stuck her fingers in her ears and said, nope, this is not me, this is not me, this is not me. And they were unwilling to repent. And in Amos 4, verse 12, the hammer falls and the clock strikes midnight. And God is going to turn the dawn into darkness and they are going to feel the heat from God the judge. This is fun to talk about, isn't it? Why has God laid this book on our hearts to study? How does God want to roar into our lives? And I want to close with this. God wants us to be for justice and to live righteously if we say that we follow him. And there's two types of righteousness. The first righteousness has to come first, and that's passive righteousness. That is righteousness that happens to us. See, when we hear stuff like this, our hearts start beating fast, and we start thinking if we can just go, and do more, and do more, and do more, then that means we can earn our way to God. But the beautiful part about God, the beautiful thing about Jesus, is that we were always going to fall short no matter how hard we exhaust ourselves to do something. And here's what he said. You don't have to do anything. I want to take the step first. And so God did what you and I could never do for ourselves. And he came and he lived perfectly because he knew that Israel was imperfect and he knew that every single one of us in here was going to blow it. And can we all just raise our hands so that all of us in here will know that we've all blown it? Raise your hand if you've ever blown it. I want to raise my feet, my legs, everything. And here's the beautiful part. When we hear this, what we have to remember is that God knew it. And so he came and offered a sacrifice on the cross and was resurrected, which means that you and I were offered a free gift of salvation. Is there anything free anymore? This is free. And when we accept that free gift, God forgives our sins and he offers us a better life here and he offers us an eternal life if we will only acknowledge him as the one true God. And I want to be crystal clear about something. There are not different paths to God. There is one way to God, and that is through Jesus Christ. And Israel knew that God was the one true God, and they were supposed to be a light to the nations, and instead they became like everyone else. Christians believe that there is one true God, and we are called to be a light, and yet sometimes our lives look no different. And we have to come back to that passive righteousness. God, you have done for me what I can never do for myself. So then, once we accept that passive righteousness, then we want to pursue active righteousness. Once we accept that free gift, then we have a responsibility to pursue righteousness, which we show through our actions. And that's why Scripture says faith without works is dead. And we scratch our heads and say, wait a minute, I thought salvation wasn't works-based. It isn't. Our salvation isn't based on what we do, but what we do indicates that we have salvation. See, that's what happened with Zacchaeus. He accepted a better way of life. He was changed, and it caused him to be radically different. And here's the thing. Every single person who came into contact with Zacchaeus, Zacchaeus did not have to be their Holy Spirit. And can we say that? There's nothing more obnoxious than a person who tries to be the Holy Spirit. There's one Holy Spirit. Let's let him be that. But what God calls you and I to do is be different. So that when people see us, a light comes on. They say, what do you have? But I don't think I have that. Because you seem to have a peace. I don't have that. You seem to have hope in the midst of your child going through something. I don't have that. And he wants us to actively pursue righteousness and live differently. And we are responsible for our actions. And our actions indicate our connection. And for those of us who've been in church for a while, we have heard this so much that it can become cliche. Because I think that we can easily slip into a sense of entitlement too. And we're going to talk a little bit more about this next week, but it's called taking advantage of God's grace. That was Israel's problem. And if we're honest, sometimes it's ours. Could we individually and corporately be accused of the same things that Amos was confronting Israel on? So I want to close with this. Passages like Amos either terrify or comfort. They terrify us when we stick our fingers in our ears and say, nope, not going to change, not going to change, not going to change. And that fear is ours. They comfort us when we realize that you and I are still in the 11th hour, that God is going to come back one day, and then the chances will be over. But right now, you and I, if we look in this mirror and we say, yes, I believe that narcissism and an empty worship might actually be a problem in my life, that we can go before God and say, forgive me. I don't want to do this anymore. You call me to be a light, and that's who I want to be. Will you help me get back on track? Because that's who He is as God. Are we consumed with self? Are we just going through a checklist, an empty checklist that's just religious rituals? Or do we want our relationship with God to be lived out in our lives? If this is us, it's time for an awakening. Lord God, this is kind of a tough word. It's hard to look in the mirror. Here's what we know. Some of us need an awakening. I know in my own heart, I've realized that there are some places that have been pretty dead, pretty complacent. Would you today wake us up to the reality of who you have called us to be and help us to know that it is not too late to say, hey, this is me. And if we admit that, would your grace cover us and help us to walk out of here saying, I want to do something different. You're a good God. Thank you for loving us enough to speak to us the same way you spoke to Israel. In your name I pray. Amen. Everybody take a deep breath. Everybody stand up. If this is where you are today and you realize you need an awakening, as you leave, the band's going to be here and continuing in worship. If you need to stay in here and worship and do business with God, great. If something was stirred up in you and you realize that you need prayer over something, there are people in our prayer corner who want to pray with you. Would you not leave here today without doing business if that's something that God needed to do in your heart today? And you know, there's nothing more powerful than serving others when we realize that we need an awakening. And after the second service today, there's a wrap meeting where you might have the chance to wrap around foster families. If you want to stay and come to that, we're going to have a light lunch in the atrium. We'd love for you to be a part. We have a good God who loves us enough to speak to us. May we listen to His words today. You're dismissed. Today, but you know what? God loves us enough to speak to us. If you need an awakening, today is the day to do it.